Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another episode here on Talk with Ryan. And today we have a special guest on the show. Some may know her, some may not. This is Christy Shea, and introduce yourself.
Hi, Ryan. My name's Christy Shea, as you said. I'm an English teacher, English as a second language teacher, and I work with the University of Pennsylvania's English language programs. And I think for your purposes, I can tell you that I was teaching some of the union players for, I guess, was spanning four seasons for me. Our program worked with them from 2015 to 2019. I worked with some of the guys from 2016 through 2019. So that's a basic intro.
All right, awesome. So what's the best part of teaching English? What's rewarding experiences that you've had over the years?
I think in general, I love working with people from different countries. You know, learning about their cultures, their backgrounds, it's just interesting to me. I grew up outside of the US myself, so I feel like I connect with people from other countries and feel at home with them. I think with the union guys, it was a whole different type of teaching and whole different topics. So it was really interesting and fun for me to kind of take English teaching in a different direction. And it made me a fan of the team. It made me, for the first time, a fan of a Philadelphia team, I guess. I mean, I was a bandwagon fan of Philadelphia teams, but this made me, you know, really want to follow and see how the team is doing, not just my own students, but the team in general. And so I think that was really exciting and fun. But just to also learn to teach not only different topics, but teach in a new way, not for academic settings, but for kind of more specific, for their specific job and for their role. So I think that was really interesting for me.
Yeah, it's definitely a really, really cool experiences that you get to form and different relationships, you know, the fans may not get to have with these players. So that's really cool. And so you mentioned that you lived in another country. Where is that, and can you speak any languages besides English?
I grew up in a small country in West Africa called Sierra Leone. It's right on the coast.
I think Michael Lapuz.
Yes, and Kai Kamara.
Yes.
Kai. So I follow Kai because I like when he goes back to Sierra Leone. It kind of brings back my memories. He goes back at least once a year, and that's fun to see. So I learned to speak a language there that is actually called a Creole language. It means it's a mixture. It's a mixture of English with other languages. So some of the words are actually based on English, but when you hear it spoken, it doesn't really sound very close to English at all. So I learned that as a kid. And in high school, I studied Spanish. In college, I studied Spanish. I never used it enough to become really fluent or anything. I can, you know, dabble in it in a bit. But that did help with working with some of the union guys, because a lot of the Portuguese speakers, the Brazilian guys, also understand English or Spanish. And there's some crossover there. And so it was helpful. For example, Anderson, I don't know if you remember Anderson, who was a center back who played in the 2016 season. And he didn't play a lot, actually, but we worked with him. He started at the very beginning level, and he was from Brazil, but he also could understand Spanish, and so just having a tiny bit of Spanish helped with him, and Sergio also last year. And then as an adult, I spent a year in East Africa teaching English in the country of Tanzania, and while I was there, I learned some Swahili, Kiswahili. The Swahili language, which is a really fun language. I've tried to keep that up a little bit over the years. That's much better than my Spanish because I actually lived in the country and used it. That's basically it for languages.
Cool. So you mentioned you worked with Anderson. What other players have you worked with? Sergio, you said. Who else have you worked with over the years?
This is going to be a little bit of a long answer. In 2016 season when I joined, we had basically two groups of guys, and I worked with kind of the lower English guys, but once in a while, I worked with the higher group. The main ones I worked with that year, Anderson, Ilsenio, Fabinho, that year with my three key guys. But that year, my colleagues also worked with a number of guys, Tranquilo Barnetta, Vince Noguera, Roland Ahlberg, Walter Restrepo. There were a couple others in the higher group that were involved as well, I believe. But those were kind of some of the key guys. I should have looked back to see who all was in that higher group. Those were the key ones. Then the next season we continued with Fabinho Elsinho, a little bit with Gigliano.
Wijnaldum, yeah.
Wijnaldum. Mm-hmm. A little bit with him. And then we got Mbaizo joined, I think, the next season, and Michi Ngalina. Mm-hmm. And then we got some of the Bethlehem Steel guys also that we got to work with. Throughout this whole time, we continued with Fabinho and Elsinho. They were kind of like our core guys that stuck with us throughout. And it was really fun to see how their English progressed. Then this last season, I worked with Sergio. Mm-hmm. Let's see here, Sergio, and then Carlos Miguel Coronel. He was a goalkeeper for about half the season. We worked with him last year too, while he was here.
Okay, so what kind of strategies? How do you make it fun for the players? Obviously, you know, they might not, after a long day of training, they might not be ready just to sit down in class. What ways do you make learning English fun for the players?
So what I think fun, we try to make it relevant. I think that's a key thing. And then there's more buy-in. So, you know, not just teaching straight up English grammar and vocab, but trying to make it be pertinent to what they need for their job. But fun in the way that, like, last year, some of the guys were pretty competitive. And so we tried to include, like, games, like, bingo and, you know, things like that to make it so that they enjoy the competitive aspect of it. Tried to make it, you know, as hands-on as possible. We did have a textbook, but we created a lot of the textbook was mostly just basic English skills, but we tried to create our own stuff as much as possible to make it be, you know, relevant to them and stuff that they could relate to. Let me share my screen with you if that's okay, and I'll show you a quick example. This is one way to make it relevant. So we would sometimes take interviews that they did. This is one that Carlos Miguel Coronel did with after he played in the match last year versus Columbus, and they did an interview, and he had a translator give the answers. He could actually speak, you know, but you know, an interview is a whole other ballgame to try to speak English. So he had a translator. And so, you know, we would do this activity where they'd try to listen for the missing key words there. But then we would also highlight words that the interviewer or the person translating for him used key expressions that we wanted to know them to know because we thought this is really useful for you. So like good result, you know, good opportunity. A shutout, you know, these are keywords that they're going to hear a lot, rivalry. So we want to make it be, you know, relevant to what they're doing. And then they can listen to themselves doing the interview and then they kind of rib each other. Oh, listen to you in the interview, you know, so we would do stuff like that. And you know, talking about injuries, which isn't necessarily fun for them, but practicing, I can talk a lot more about that, but, one fun thing, I'll show you this other one if I can pull it up. This is basic. This was really basic English, but a couple of the guys needed this level of basic when they first arrived. You know, elbow, that's not a word you automatically know in English. You know, shin, things like these are words. So we would play bingo with these. We use this eventually with even pictures. And then we got a little more complex with bingo. We got into, this is all the different cards, so everybody could have a different one. We got into muscles even injuries. So, you know, they learned hip flexor and abdominals. And, mm-hmm. you know, now I'm even forget. I learned things because I didn't know all these, you know, Achilles. Yeah. calf, you know, just because these things come up as you are a player, this is part of their job. So, you know, they need to know some of these things. And we even did words you use to describe your pain. Now that's not fun. So we trying to make it relevant to them, trying to make it, you know, useful in terms of being fun and interactive. A couple times we did go on the field, not very often, but we would do, especially with the guys who are lower level, like the, you know, most of them pick up this field stuff really quickly, but I can just quickly show you this document. There's words that you have to be able to say very, very quickly or hear very quickly and respond to very quickly. And, you know, it's a whole different thing if you're using English to write something out. You have time to stop and think. If you're trying to read something or if somebody says something to you out in regular conversation in life, you might have time to pull up your dictionary and check the meaning. But like in the middle of practice or in the middle of a game, you obviously have to be able to respond quickly. And so we practiced a lot with keywords for some of the guys with the lower level, just to get, you know, these things like turn, you know, behind, you know. If you've ever tried learning another language, things like prepositions like behind and forward and back, it takes you a long time for that to become automatic.
Yeah. I kind of speak German a little bit, so
cool.
I can sort of relate.
Yeah, so if you're still pretty new at it and you can imagine like when someone says a word, it takes your brain a couple seconds, even 1 second to process, you know.
Yeah.
They just say, oh yeah, okay. You don't have time for that 1 second in the middle of play. It has to be automatic. And that's a point in language that takes a lot of repetition and a lot of time. And so, you know, things like just in front, behind, back, left, right, between, around. So even these prepositions that they need, basic words, but they really, really need to have as an automatic, just pull that out of your brain immediately. So if someone says it to you or you can say it, shout it to somebody else.
Wow, that's really cool that you get to, you've gotten to form those bonds with those players and just get to be there as they learn the language of English. So. This last question is more fun, more get to know you. I ask this, not that I interview a lot of people, but when I do, I like to ask them this question. You're going on a road trip, and you got to pick one snack and one drink. What are you going to pick?
On a road trip, one snack and one drink. Oh my gosh, the snack is pretty easy for me because I love crunchy, salty things. So potato chips or pretzels, salty, crunchy. That's my snack go-to. To drink, I'm boring, I usually just drink water. But if it's a long road trip and I need caffeine, it would probably be tea, which is again kind of boring.
Mm-hmm.
I drink, yeah, not so interesting.
That's what Papa said when
the other thing that people tease me about that I always eat is I'm constantly eating almonds, like all day long. And
uh-huh.
So maybe it'd be almonds too.
All right. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you guys for watching this video. And I will see you next time on Talk Deep with Ryan.
I'm Alejandro Bedoya, and you're watching Talk Deep with Ryan.